I thank thee, Lord, for glorious life that flows within my veins. Its thrilling music, born of heaven, flows on in ceaseless strains. The grandeur of my mission here inspires me through all time. And so I praise my Maker's love, who gave me life sublime. Praise God for life, for glorious life, for power to war against sin and strife, for health and strength and hope and love. Praise God for life, for glorious life.
I welcome you to this presentation called Summer Surprises Out of a Picninc Basket. And you can see the picninc basket here. We all like picnics, don't we? And I'm going to invite you to go on a picninc with me. How good is your imagination? I would like to take you on a picninc with me to one of my favourite places. So we're going to drive the car and we're going to go down a small lane. We're going to park the car and then we're going to walk. And we're going to walk along a lovely golden sandy beach. That sandy beach is a beautiful place. It's a lovely warm summer afternoon. There are tiny little waves coming up. And as we walk, we look at shells. We leave footprints through the sand. But then we come up to the other side where there's a hill going up the other side. And as we start to climb the hill, the grass is that lovely short grass that you get where sheep have been, and it's really springy, but it takes quite a bit of climbing to go up. In fact, we follow a path with what's known locally as a sheep trod, and it's where generations of sheep have gone round this hillside. So we follow that path and we go up quite a bit higher till we find just the spot to sit down with our picnic basket. It is so nice. And the view from here is wonderful. We put everything down, we put something down to sit on, we put down our picnic basket, and then we sit ourselves down on the grass. Above us, the sky is blue, and everything is so still. All you can hear is the waves lapping on the side of the cliffs to our left. They are so steep and full of seabirds. In fact, you can hear them calling for a long way off. And those seabirds are kittiwakes, and they get their name from the way they call. Because as they're coming into their nest, they call kittiwake, kittiwake, kittiwake. And you can hear them for a long way off. And as we sit there, we enjoy the scenery. And we begin to think, I'm hungry. I wonder what's in that picnic basket. And so we unpack the picnic basket and look at all these beautiful things that came in the picnic basket. There's a lovely loaf of bread here, and there's more bread, there's rye bread, there's crisp breads, and we've got some salad, and we've got some tomatoes, we've got peppers, and we've got lots and lots of fruit, and we've got nuts, and we've got homegrown salad here, and it's all ready for us to eat. All these things are so good. And in fact, I think before we actually start eating, we ought to say grace. Saying grace is where we thank God for all his goodness to us and all his grace to us. In fact, I think it might be quite nice if we were to sing our grace. It's one you might remember from school days. I'm reminded of another picnic that I once took part in that I really enjoyed. It was a picnic in the Alps, and it was so simple. There were snowy mountains to one side of me and a tartan picnic rug, and we sat and we ate. There were brown bread rolls. To go on the bread rolls, There was just ordinary tomato puree, the double concentrate type of tomato puree that we use for cooking, and that was spread on the bread rolls. And then a little pinch of garlic salt spread on it. Do you know, those rolls in that Alpine air were just absolutely wonderful, with some green salad to go with it as well. Cucumber and tomatoes, green leaves and rocket, things like that. And to finish with, we had just a little bit of flapjack, and that was just the right finishing touch for a lovely picnic. Now, do you notice the things that we've got out of our picnic basket here? Did you notice how colourful everything is? So bright and so wonderful. All those different colours. There's reds and purples and yellows and green grapes and purple grapes, even the goldy coloured pineapple and pears and blueberries. And we've got different nuts here in brownie colours. This is our protein. We've got hazelnuts and we've got cashew nuts. And we've got greeny pears and we've got, oh, so many different things. In fact, I can smell the strawberries. When you look at all the things that we've got in our picnic basket, the wonder of it is, if you think about it, there is not a single product that once had a face. All these things are made from the fruits and the vegetables and the nuts and the grains and the seeds that God has given us. And these things are what God originally intended us to eat. You see, who was the one that made us? It was God that made us. God made this earth in 6 days. And in the 6 days, he made all these things. In fact, it was on the third day of creation that he made all these beautiful things. So when Adam and Eve were created on the sixth day, then God said to them, I want you to eat just the fruits and things like that, and the nuts and the seeds. They could eat those things as well. And that's what he gave them for their diet. That's when people were perfect. That's what they ate. Pure, simple, clean, colourful, fresh food. I bet they didn't have plates to put them on. I wonder if they went and put the fruit on a leaf. I imagine that's what it might have been like, and what a colourful meal they must have had. We know that a little bit later, Adam and Eve disobeyed God. We call it the fall, when they fell into sin and temptation. They fell from their perfect state. And after that, God said to them, I'm going to give you something different to eat now. I'm going to give you the green leaves to eat. Now, we know that green leaves have lots of minerals and lots of vitamins and lots of fiber that we wouldn't get from just eating fruits and seeds and grains. And so God supplemented their diet with the green vegetables. And of course, the more we eat them raw, the better it is for us. But why did God give them rules like this? You might have said, surely God wasn't giving them rules at that early stage. We don't like rules. But I'm sorry to say that everything that we have and do is governed by rules. And God has actually given us 8 rules to keep our health. Let's look and see what those 8 rules are. The first rule is good food. Good food, of fresh food from God's creation. And then he gave us exercise to follow. Ah, we don't like exercise, do we? But that's a rule that we have. And then God said, I'm giving you water to drink. Water. We have lots of water today. We've got some in our picnic basket. And did you know that each day our bodies require 3 of these glasses full of fresh water? Not tea, not coffee, not fruit juice, not alcohol, but fresh, clear water. And it's that water that keeps our blood circulating and keeps it thin. It keeps our temperature right, particularly on a hot day. And we need that water. Have you ever seen a vase of flowers where the water has dropped down in the vase and those poor flowers wilt? And that's what happens to us if we don't get enough. Because in fact, 7/8 of our body is just full of water. And if that water level drops, we get dehydrated and we're in trouble. So water is an essential part of what we need every day. 3 pints. And then we're told that we need to have temperance. We need to have self-control. Because when we've got a lot of nice food, we really want to eat too much. But we need self-control to be able to say and regulate ourselves and be able to say, that's enough. That was really nice what I've had, but no more, thank you. I'll stop now. Thank you very much. And we must learn that lesson. And that's one of God's rules that he wants to bring us back to. And then what we need is sunshine. And we had lots of sunshine when we walked up our hill to come to the picnic spot. And then we need fresh air. And fresh air is so good for us, particularly if it's air beside the sea or beside a waterfall. That kind of fresh air is much fresher, and it's pure air, and it has negative ions in it. I'll tell you why we need those. Because down in our lungs, we have lots of little things like this going, ooh, tiny, tiny, microscopic little things called cilia. And when we're in a smoky atmosphere or central heating or a stuffy atmosphere where everybody's been breathing all day in a big hall or a theatre or a cinema, then we find that those little cilia don't work and they drop down. And so they've found that if you can have these negative ions by a waterfall, by water, by the sea, you will be much healthier and the fresh air you get will actually do you more good. But there's another thing as well that we need, and we're all guilty of it, we need more rest. And that rest means all sorts of different things. It doesn't just mean sleeping, but by the way, did you get your 8 hours sleep last night? Or did you have a few hours less than that because you were still doing something at midnight? This is what we've got to really work at. Our bodies need to be alive. And then they need to rest and stop. It doesn't even do any harm to have a power nap, just like they do in hot countries. In fact, there are some countries in Europe that I've visited. I visited a medical man in Germany once, and he used to lie down on the bench in his treatment room and just have 20 minutes after lunch every day. And he was only a young man. I know a taxi driver. And he has 1/4 hour after lunch when he can. And those few minutes really put back in your body what you need. It'd be nice to be like a cat, wouldn't it? And just curl up and sleep and just relax. You know, if you've seen a dog or a cat, they just flop. But what about all your busy day? Do you work in an office looking at a computer all day? Do you do lots of running around all day? Lots of domestic work, then rest for you is the opposite of what you've been doing. So if you have been doing a lot of computer work, then you need to go in the allotment and do a good half hour's digging. If you have been doing a tremendous lot of running around kind of jobs all day on your feet, like many people are, think of the people that empty the bins, they're just running with doing their work, or the postman that walks miles. Those people then need to stop and put their feet up and read a good book. Why have we got rules like this? It's because God made us. God gave us a body, and that body, our physical body, is governed by rules. Oh, I know, you're rebelling. You don't like what I'm saying. And nor did I when I first started hearing these things either. But if you think about it, everything has got rules and cycles and rhythms, and we should have exactly the same. If you think of the water in the ocean, it comes up, it evaporates, it forms the clouds hit a mountain or come to higher ground, and it drops as rain. Everything keeps going as a cycle. And so God has given us our cycles of eating, of rest, and our sleep, and our occupation and all those things to look after our physical body. Now, when you think of our physical body as well, there are other parts to it which are important for us to know, because our physical body is something that when you look at women's magazines, all they do are emphasize the bonuses of a diet like this. If you eat this way, if you live this way, you will be slim, you will be beautiful, you will be young. Aren't these the things they say? Looking for the new you. I'm going to go much, much deeper than that. I want to show you that we're not just physical people. We have a mind. So there is a physical part of us and a mental part. I can tell you an example about this. Some time ago, I met an elderly lady, and I mean elderly, and she, for the first time, had come across hearing things like this. And she decided she was going to give it a try. And so she had lots of fresh fruit smoothies, she had lots of salad, it took her a long time to chew it, but she tried, and she tried to eat anything that was natural. So no fish, no chicken, no meat, no dairy, all those things she cut out because they had all come from something that once had a face. And so she substituted with all the things that God made in creation. And she told me so excitedly, not many weeks later, that at the Evergreen Club for the elderly, they were having a quiz afternoon. And at that quiz afternoon, she found that she could remember so much more. And the answers were coming so quickly that then they were having to say, look, Alice, stop, stop. We're going to have to handicap you because none of the rest of us have got a chance. And this just didn't happen once. It happened every week. She found she could remember her shopping list better. And remember, this was an elderly lady. And she was rejoicing because she discovered that if you follow God's rules for your body, your mind starts getting better. And, you know, on our picnic, could we have been miserable on our picnic? No, because we were having all that God had given us. If you think we had the exercise to get there, we had the fresh air, we had the sunshine, we had the temperance to say, no, I've really had enough, I've got to be in all things in moderation here, even the nice things. And everything we had, we lay back and we put our hands behind our head, we looked up at the clouds and we rested. We had everything that God has told us to do on a picnic. And we also had our mental side because we felt so cheerful and so relaxed that we actually sang the grace to be thankful for what we had and what we were doing. But now there is another part, and I'm going to tell you another story about an elderly lady. And she was also beginning to discover things like this, but she had cancer. And it wasn't a very good cancer. It wasn't moving very quickly, but it was beginning to cause her some discomfort. She knew about the healthy things. She knew about the mental. But what she didn't know was that inside our physical being, we have another being. We have a spiritual being. And the spiritual being is the part that the women's magazines forget. They tell you about having a new and beautiful you. They tell you that your middle age may be extended for a long time, that you can begin as late as you wish and still have benefits. They know a little bit that your mind is sharper and clearer and very often calmer by living that kind of life, but nobody tells you the effect on your spiritual life. Now, to get back to this lady, she had this tumour which was growing and it was giving concern to her and her daughter, and she trusted God. And one night when she was saying her prayers, she said, Father, please show me. There's something I'm not doing right. I'm trying to do the other things right, but something isn't working out well. Can you tell me what it is? And as quick as a flash into her mind came, why are you still holding that grudge that you've been holding for 40 years against that person? She took a deep gasp. It was absolutely right. She had been holding a grudge. But she said, Lord, that person deserved that. They were not kind. I can't forgive them. I cannot. And God said to her, but you asked me. You did. You asked me to help you. I'm helping you. Will you listen? It's your choice. And she thought about it before she went to sleep. She thought about it when she woke up. And then she said, Lord, I am holding a grudge. I'm not being good. I might look good on the outside, but inside, in my heart of hearts, there's something very rotten. I'm not surprised that my body and my mind are not functioning as well as they should be, and I'm feeling miserable some of the time. She said, Lord, I want you to take that away from me. Show me how. I'm going to give it to you and give that other person to you for you to look after. I can't sort it out. I can't put it right with them. It's too long ago. And Lord, I'm going to have to ask you to take care of it and for you to look after that person. And I'm going to have to just walk away and forgive. And she knew she was right. She went back to the hospital several weeks after, and they did a scan to have a look at her tumour. And it was only half the size that it had been. Well, you can imagine her delight. Because she had cared for her physical part, she cared for her mental part by doing quizzes and keeping her brain active. And now she was putting her life right. And because of that, she was more cheerful in her mind, and even the tumour in her body was beginning to recede. That's a true story. And the last time I heard about that lady, that tumour had shrunk to virtually nothing. And she was bounding with life. She was cooking, she was helping at a big social gathering. She was running around with her face beaming with smiles. The kind of person that you'd want to sit with and chat with. The kind of person when you've finished, you just want to put your arms around them and say, thank you, I feel refreshed from just being with you. And that was because she saw herself now as three components, her physical, her mental, and her spiritual. Now, do you remember earlier on, we talked about the laws that God has given us, the laws of good food and water and exercise and rest and doing all things in moderation? Do you remember all that? God had one other rule that we hadn't mentioned. And that one other rule that we hadn't mentioned was that we have to trust in divine power. Trust in divine power. Does God have power? How would you demonstrate to somebody that God has power? Look at this apple. Look at the lovely colours on its skin. Could you make that? Could a scientist make that apple? Could an evolutionist make that apple? God made the apple. God has the power to make the apple. And God says to us, oh, taste and see that God is good. And really, he's showing us himself through the things that he has made. Let's just think about this for a minute. If somebody said to me, you need to eat a lot more fresh fruit than you do, I think, yes, that's right, that's true, I probably do. Yes, that's good, I quite agree with that. And you held these apples in your hand and you looked at it. How much good would it do you? Not a lot. In fact, you'd get tired of holding them because they're heavy. But if, as God says, taste and see that God is good, as soon as you put your teeth into a big juicy apple like that, you discover that lovely sweet sharp taste. These were fresh off a tree, full of the sunshine and the rainwater. Made by you? No, made by God. Well, let's look at the skin first. On the skin of this apple, there are different colours. There's the green and there's the red. And did you know that the red colour on the outside in the skin has got a lot of different chemicals? And those chemicals, they are called phytochemicals. They're very smart chemicals and they can go straight to parts of our body that we need to fight illness and fight disease and regenerate our bodies. So the two different colours in that apple are going to be very helpful to us. So now we've taken that bite of the apple, immediately there's juice running down our jaws, if you like, from a lovely juicy apple. But you can't just swallow it, can you? You have to chew an apple. And as you chew it and you mix it with your saliva, a lot of goodness comes out of that apple. In fact, there are minerals in the apple. There are vitamins in the apple. There are fibres in the apple. And the fibres we call pectin. That's the special one that's in an apple. Pectin is what helps the jam set when you're making jam sometimes. And if we have pectin in the apple, it's like a jelly kind of substance that soothes and goes right through your whole system. In fact, if eating an apple is a bit like taking a brush to your system and it brushes everything out. So if you have a green apple and a dark red apple every day, you are doing yourself a power of good. God says, oh, taste and see that God is good. But if we have a Bible, the Bible is filled with commands that God has given us, laws that he's given us. And he says, oh, taste and see that God is good. So you have your 8 hours sleep and you wake up feeling so much more refreshed because God has given us these things to help us to live and to grow and to be the kind of people that he wants to be. He wants us to be. He wants us to be fully regenerated, rejuvenated. That's why he gives us the commands that he gives us. But he also gives us a lot of promises. And one of those promises is that we eat and taste and see that God is good, that we follow what he's asked us to do, and when we follow what he's asked us to do, then we find that it is well with us. And God has promised us that it will be well with us and our children. As mums, we know that when we're pregnant, if we lived with a diet like this, we would have such strong, healthy babies. That's what God intended. He didn't intend all the sickness there is in the world today, but he's asked us to live by those 8 rules. For the simple reason that we can then have a complete body, physical, mental, and spiritual, that all work together as one unit. Did you know that God had a very special rule for us? And not many people know this, but God made the world in 6 days, but he did something special on the 7th day. On the 7th day, God said, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And the Sabbath day means remember the rest day to keep it holy. When I was working, I would have been absolutely overjoyed if my boss had come through the door and said, okay, tomorrow there's no work for anybody. You can all stay at home. You can do what you want at home. You don't have to come in and do my work. What a lovely offer. And God is offering us every week, on the 7th day of the week, on Saturday each week. You look at a calendar, begins on a Sunday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. That's the 6 days, and God says we work. And the seventh day, which is Saturday, at the end of most calendars, that is the day that God has said, I don't want you to work on that day. It's a special day. Take time to thank me, to praise me for what I've done, to tell other people about me, and that will strengthen you. I've been doing that for all my life nearly now. And during that time, I can sometimes come to Friday afternoon and think, oh, I've got so much to do. Look at that big basket of ironing I still haven't done because I've been doing this and because I've been doing the other. And these things aren't done. But then the Sabbath comes and I stop. And I don't move again until Sunday morning, not with domestic things. But on Sunday morning, I wake up and I look out the window, and it doesn't matter whether it's raining or shining, but I feel full of energy, new energy. And then the ironing pile goes down like that, and it was nowhere near as big as I thought. And the sorting out jobs of the drawers, nowhere near as big as they seemed on Friday morning. Suddenly, everything is restored into order. And so, by all the things from the picnic basket, God is trying to restore us into order. This is what we're so many people are missing in this world. There is no order. There is no routine. There's nothing that they can follow as a set pattern. And all of us, our bodies, our minds, our spiritual life, work better working to routines. And this is the way God has programmed us to live, if you like. We understand that other things are programmed. Do the apples appear on the tree in springtime? No, of course they don't. Do we go out into the garden on Christmas Day and find a strawberry under the leaves? No. Everything that we have comes at a special time. The swallows come in the spring. The swallows fly in the autumn. The Bible tells us that even the stork and the swallow and the turtle dove, they know when they're supposed to be flying away, and they come back at the right time. They obey God. Do you know, it's only humanity that doesn't. That's because we try to be independent. We don't need God. We don't want God. That's only a crutch for the weak people in the world. But I tell you something, that if you follow what God has asked us to do, you will have your order and your life and your family restored to a peacefulness and a goodness that you would never have dreamt possible. Because God's way is well with us. That's what he says. That's what he wants it to be. He gives us this glorious life. But just think of some of the ways we cheat. There's a lovely orange here. That is a good orange, full of vitamin C, full of fiber. Even this skin here is good for us as well. There are chemicals in here that help our body, but you should look for ones that haven't got wax on them if you're going to grate that off and eat it. Even the white stuff inside in the pith, even that is good for you. Within an orange are special things called bioflavonoids, and those are built in to help your system. But then we think, oh, I'm late. I'm going to be sticky. If I start peeling this orange now, I'm going to get so sticky, and I'm going to be late for work if I do this. And we just don't want to do it. Oh, but had you noticed the smell when you do that? There are beautiful oils in that skin. And those oils are so good if you need revivifying. Just take a little bit of oil from there and just rub on your lip there and just breathe it in. And if you're on a long flight of a long journey, that will refresh you. That's a very good thing to do. But we don't make the time to eat it as God intended. We do something else instead. We pour out a glass of water. And in that glass of water, we put in a tablet, a fizzy tablet. And in a few minutes, It's all dissolved. We drink it down and we think, I've had my orange for the day. I've had my vitamin C. But I tell you, there's no nice oils in there. And those oils remain a long time on your skin. They're not in there. That has got a man-made kind of vitamin C. That has got the real thing in it. But then some parents go round the shop and they think, I think my child needs more orange. And we go and buy one of those, an orange lolly, and we put it in the lunchbox. And we see them licking that orange and we think, well, I've done the best I can. They don't like those, but at least they've had an orange lolly. You know, this is how we try to cheat on what God has given us and what God has told us to do. We try to do things our way, and it's not the right way. And so I hope that you have had some idea of what God wants you to do. God's ways are best. God's ways are healthy. In a simple picnic basket, we can enjoy many, many things. Will you just bow your heads in a prayer with me, and we will ask God for his blessing and thank him for all the good things he's given for us. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the very many blessings that we've seen. We've heard how at the end of creation you gave people the diet that they should eat. Even after they fell into sin, you still gave them the diet that they needed. And we have wandered far. We're sorry. We'd like to come back and live as you would want us to live. We thank you for caring for us and being interested in us. Thank you for everything. May we trust you and obey you and follow you to find a good physical life, to find a good mental life, and to find a good spiritual life, so that all is one. All can reflect your love in our lives to other people. This is my prayer. In the name of Jesus, who loved us so much. Amen.